I just wanted to start off by saying a few words about why we're here. Why does this subject matter? After all, the capitalist system is built on inequality. It's built on the idea that people get differential rewards for different contributions to the economic system. You need to provide people with incentives to work. You need to provide people with different rewards. If people come up with a good idea, they deserve to get some money for it in order to exploit the idea, to market the idea, to capitalize the idea, to build firms on the basis of that ideas. And on the other hand, capitalist societies over the last decades have done an enormous amount to address the problem of sort of inequality. They've built gigantic welfare states. They've built gigantic educational systems. You know, one of the great achievements of the post-war era is mass education. I think in 1945, the school leaving age in Italy was 12 years old. We've built huge welfare systems to provide people with opportunities to look after people in their old age or if they're unemployed. Why do we care about this issue? Also, I must say, when I was at university in the late 1970s, the great issue which animated politics was too much equality. We had too much equality, which was destroying the system of incentives on which capitalism is based. People were fleeing from Britain because there was a penalty for entrepreneurship. The education system was being destroyed, really, by comprehensive education, by imposing equality on people. We had communism advancing rather than retracting. So it looked as though the problem then was too much equality. Now, obviously, things are very, very different. Now, people are very worried about inequality. You have the extraordinary phenomenon of Piketty, who made a lot of money by lamenting inequality. You have people from the right saying exactly the same things. Charles Murray, a sort of classic libertarian, talking about the unraveling of society. You have David Brooks in the New York Times saying that inequality represents capitalism's greatest moral crisis since the Great Depression. You have Joel Kotkin saying we're creating a new feudal society with a narrow class of oligarchs and tenured radical clerics at the top and struggling yeomen and peasants at the bottom. You have Walter Russell Mead talking about how we now live in a Downton Abbey economy, which might well explain why people want to watch that extraordinary, ghastly series. So you have a consensus emerging that the problem now is very different from the late 1970s. The problem is too much inequality, and I think that consensus is right. That consensus is really animating politics at the moment. So you have Obama saying that the defining issue of our time is inequality. You have Jeb Bush talking about the growing chasm between rich and poor and creating an un-American society and saying that that is the greatest problem facing America. I think he's right. So inequality does matter. Inequality is the central issue of our time. And the reason for that is partly a matter of degree. It's partly that we've moved from a system in which we have the right amount of inequality to provide people with incentives and motivations to one in which I think we have probably too much inequality and a degree of inequality which is threatening the legitimacy of the overall system. So Chris rightly put up a chart of what was happening in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, but it's beginning to feel very much like that at the moment. If you think of the early 20th century with that degree of inequality, you had the problem of Bolshevism, you have the problem of fascism, you have a reaction against inequality. And I think you're beginning to see that now. The rage against the establishment is beginning to destroy the basis of our society. We have Trump, we have Sanders, we have Brexit, we have all sorts of things which are eroding the consensus upon which the liberal regime is based. I think you also have a matter of a problem of calcification, that social inequalities are becoming self-reinforcing. Just as you have to have equality of opportunity just as equality of opportunity creates inequality of results, inequality of results is becoming self-perpetuating. So a society based on class, on mobility, on upward mobility, is becoming a society in which that mobility is denied, in which society reinforces itself. The level of social mobility is going down in Britain, it's going down in the United States. The elites are getting much better at transmitting their privileges. you're getting a marriage between plutocracy and meritocracy, which is extremely dangerous, I think. You look at Harvard University, the average pay of people whose parents, the average pay of the parents who send their children to Harvard University is $450,000 a year. At Oxford University, more than half the students are independently educated. Independent schools educate 7% of the population in Britain. So we're moving from a system of equality of opportunity to a system of entrenched and transmitted privilege. That undermines the legitimacy of the system. Americans now, by a 2-to-1 majority, say that they will not participate in the American dream, that their children are not going to get rich in the way that they get richer than they were. And that rises to 2-to-1 when you look at people earning less than $100,000 a year. Legitimacy of the system is being undermined. And above all, the problem of technology, or the innovations that we're seeing, the technological revolution that we're part of, threatens to reinforce all of these long-term trends. You have a system whereby technology is massively increasing the rewards for people at the top of the system. If you can invent something, if you can come up with an idea, if you can create a company, your chances of making it really big are bigger than ever before. At the same time, it's increasing the rewards with people who can take advantage of technology, who can work with the machines, who can use those machines to magnify their talents. At the bottom of the system, it's eliminating whole swathes of medium-skilled, low-skilled jobs. So what you're seeing happening to knowledge workers, to the average knowledge worker, is exactly what happened to skilled craft workers in the mid-19th century. Their comparative advantage is being destroyed. Anything that can be codified, anything that can be routinized, will be taken over by machines and destroyed. So you have a chasm opening up at the heart of society. This is a fundamental problem for our society. It's a very depressing phenomenon. But I think what we're going to talk about in the next few days is whether we can flip this phenomenon, whether we can actually see technology not as a cause of inequality, but as a solution to inequality, tease out the ways in which technology can be used to improve our situation. Technology may destroy jobs, but technology is also, in its essence, a very egalitarian thing. It creates opportunities for the masses. It provides resources to the masses, which used to be restricted only to the elites. Technology is a universalizing thing. It brings opportunities. It brings technology around the world to the corners of the world, not just to the centers of the world. Technology can be used to bring societies together as well as to divide society. And much of what technology means is a matter of choice. It's a matter of policy. It's a matter of how we craft public policy. Do we use technology to divide society, to concentrate wealth, or do we use it to solve these problems to bring society back together? I hope we're going to come up with a few solutions to this problem of inequality. A lot of people have spent a lot of time decrying technology and decrying inequality. What we're going to do, I hope, is find some ways in which technology can be used to solve these very, very serious problems. We're now going to look at the vexed question of exactly what inequality is, how you measure it, and how you go about thinking about it in a rigorous and conceptual way. Thank you.